Time for Children's Church. Boys and girls, pre-K to second grade, if you'll meet your leadership right here in the back. It's time for Children's Church.
What a great choir. Thank you, choir, this morning for sharing. I love to get to worship with them up there. They let me get up there and make a joyful noise anyway, but I do love that. And sweet service this morning, worshiping. Thank you for being a part of that. Hope that got you ready just to hear his word and to worship him together. Trey, I don't know what you're talking about. Johnson's being long-winded. I'm not long-winded. I'm just as brief can be. Don't y'all know that, right? That's right. Hey, God's word says that a day is like 1,000 years, right? So get ready. All right, if you've got your Bible with you this morning, we're going to be in a couple of places in Scripture today. Be finding John. We're going to go back to the Gospel of John, kind of continuing in the series that we began last week. We'll be in the 6th chapter. Stick something in there at John chapter 6, and then be finding Matthew, if you would. And we're going to be in the 16th chapter of Matthew for a little bit. Hopefully you have your Bible with you today, because we're going to be all over this thing, all right, in this brief moment. We're going to look at lots of passages this morning and kind of dig through Scripture. We began a series of messages last week that I think could not be more important for us today, just entitled, Who Does Jesus Say He Is? And I'll get into the importance of that question a little bit more here as we get into the topic this morning. But I just want you to think about that question as we probe over that over the next few weeks. Who does Jesus say he is? And I think that beckons us to a second question. What does that mean for my life and what am I going to do with it, right? What does that mean to me and how do I adjust my life to that? So who does Jesus himself say that he is? And I want us to kind of dig into that topic, if you would, just a little bit. You know, people make all kinds of claims about Jesus. Last week, I shared a lot of quotes with you from some pretty strange sources, a lot of world leaders, a lot of folks who we would never have thought about who Jesus was. Many people in our day-to-day will acknowledge that Jesus was actually a historical figure. He actually lived. Many people will say that he was a great teacher. And that he played his role as a great teacher. Even many world leaders such as Gandhi and the Dalai Lama and others like that will acknowledge that Jesus was a man of integrity and a great moral teacher. But I believe that he's more than that by his own claims. And this morning, we want to lean into that, dig into that just a little bit, question a little bit further, because Jesus made a lot of claims about who he was. And if who he said he was is true, then we have to adjust our life to that. We got to do something with that because he made some pretty powerful, astounding claims that we want to dig into a little bit deeper this morning. So ask you to find a couple of passages of Scripture. Want to show you some things here that I don't want you to miss, but we're going to begin in Matthew, the 16th chapter, because I kind of alluded to this last week, but I want to take a look at it today so that you can kind of dig in to what he's saying here. So we're in Matthew, the 16th chapter, going to look at verse 13 and kind of read down just a little bit so you can hear this conversation that Jesus is having with his disciples. So Matthew 16, beginning in the 13th verse. Look at that with me. Here's what happened. It says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Who do men say that I am? Verse 14, so they said, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, or others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And we know that to be a great confession of who he was. But I want you to pay close attention there to what Jesus says in this passage. He comes asking this question that's so powerful. Now, I want you to notice this. Going to give you a little bit of biblical background, a little bit of a Greek lesson this morning, if you would. You say, well, I didn't sign up for that. I didn't come to church this morning to get a Greek lesson. Well, you're going to get one here, but I think you'll find it interesting. I want to point a couple of things out to you here that I think are fascinating. I want you to look at verse 13 in your Bible there, and I want you to show you something that I think is very interesting. Right there, at the very first part of verse 13 there, notice that it says, when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying. Now, we read that passage of Scripture, and we think that this was a one-time ask, right? That one time Jesus came, and he said, who do men say that I am, and who do you say that I am? But when you study this passage deeply, and you kind of study deeply into the languages, you will understand, and you may want to circle this word right there at the beginning of verse 13, the word asked is very interesting. Normally, that would be a single occurrence. In Greek, that's called the aorist tense, okay? So that word in Greek would be spoken in aorist, and it means at one point in history, Jesus asked his disciples. But what's strange about the Bible here and the way this is written in the Greek language, that's not in the aorist tense. It's in what's called the imperfect tense in the Greek language. That means it was a continuous action. This wasn't the only time Jesus asked this question, and it wouldn't be the last time he asked this question. Jesus continued to ask this question over and over. When it says Jesus asked, it means he asked and he kept asking. He kept asking, who do men say that I am? Who do you say that I am? And I believe that even today he continues to ask that question. Who do you really say that I am? And I think about that in regard to our lives sometimes. As Christians, professing Christians, as those who go to church, as those who are believers, if you think about this, a lot of us like to take the name of Christ, right? But do we ever really let Jesus be who he is in our life? Do we ever let God be God? Are we trying to call the shots? Are we trying to pave the way ourselves? Are we making Jesus who we want him to be? When it's convenient, I'll serve him. When it's not, I won't. You see, the truth of the matter is, Jesus makes these claims about who he is, and if those claims are remotely correct, they're life-changing and powerful for your life. And it can't just be a profession of the lips one time. It's something that you're going to continue. Hear Jesus ask you, who do you really say that I am? Am I really who you claim that I am? Am I really God in the flesh? Am I really the Messiah? We know that the two most explicit claims that Jesus makes about himself in Scripture is that he was the Messiah, the Christ, and that he was God in the flesh. And every other claim that he makes kind of falls under those two things. Now, last time we were together, we talked about how Jesus' claims are either true or they're false. And you can't say he was a great moral teacher if his claims aren't true, because that means he was lying. A liar is not a great moral teacher, right? Or he's crazy. And just like many who had come along in that day claiming to be the Messiah, here's this crazy man claiming to be a Messiah. And if that's true and he's crazy, why are we paying attention to him at all? He's off his rocker. So think about this. He is either who he claims to be or he's not. There's not an in-between. And if he's who he claims to be and you believe him to be who he is, we must adjust our life to him. Okay, pray with me if you would. Father, what a wonderful time already in this place worshiping you. Being reminded, God, that we can come to you and we can cry out. And we can say, Lord, fill my cup. I lift it up. And God, this morning I feel like that's us. We stand in need of you to fill our cup. And God, we depend upon you to pour out your word, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and fill this place. God, I am convinced in my own heart that we go through the motions of church, doing church today. And God, that nothing is going to happen unless you show up and move in our midst. And God, this morning we are totally dependent upon you to move on us. God, I don't want anything to stand in the way of your Holy Spirit and what you want to do. I don't want to be in the way. Move me out of the way. And God, would you just take your word this morning and you would speak it to us? Would you speak it in such a way, Lord, that we could not miss you? Because God, the greatest need of our life today is you. And the choir just sang it. You're all we need. You're all we need. You satisfy. Your life and peace. You fill us. So God, I know that in a room like this, God, there's all kinds of reasons that folks are here today, but it's not by accident. You love each one, and you know why we're here. You know what we're dealing with. You know what we're going through, and we ask you to speak this morning. Speak, Lord. And Father, when we get ready to leave this place in just a little bit, God, we will give you the praise and the honor and the glory for what you do in this place, all to your glory. It's in your name we ask these things and committing this time to you. Amen. A burglar broke into a home one time and intent on robbing them blind. And he's going through things and putting stuff in bags and loading it all up, shining his flashlight around to see what he can find. And suddenly he hears a voice out of the darkness that says, "Jesus is watching you." He nearly jumps out of his skin thinking, "Someone's in this room with me." Turns off the flashlight, stands frozen for a few moments, listening to the darkness. He doesn't hear it anymore. So he shakes his head and he thinks, "I've got to get a new job. My nerves are getting to me. I'm hearing things." He goes back to his thievery ways, begins to load his bag with more of the poor person's belongings, and all of a sudden, clear as a bell, here comes the voice again, a little louder. "Jesus is watching you." Startled, he turns his flashlight on and begins to shine it around the room, trying to see where that voice is coming from. It's kind of eerie, it's kind of freaky, and he's ready to run, but he's got to check it out. He looks all over the room to see nothing, and suddenly he shines the flashlight into a corner, and there's a large bird cage with a bird sitting in it. And he says to the bird, "Did you say that?" "Yes," the parrot declared. And then he squawked, "I'm just trying to warn you that Jesus is watching you." The burglar relaxed. "Warn me, huh? Who in the world do you think you are?" "Well, I'm Moses," the parrot said. "Moses," the burglar replied. "What kind of people would name their bird Moses?" And the parrot responded, "The same kind of people that would name their Doberman Pinscher Jesus." Now, as far as I know, Jesus claimed to be a lot of things, but he never claimed to be a Doberman, all right? But that's a great story, right? Who is Jesus to you? And by the way, don't name your dog Jesus, and don't name your parrot Moses, all right? But that's a great story. Think about that. People make all kinds of claims about who Jesus is, but I want you to think about this, and it could not be more important. That claim, for us to hear Jesus' claims, what we're going to do with that, I want you to understand and just get in your head a little bit, kind of behind the purpose of this series of messages that we're doing, how absolutely imperative it is that we get a grip on who Jesus really is and that we adjust our life to that. Dr. Paul Washer, a preacher that I love, says this, and I find this really interesting, this statement that he makes. He says, "Whether you want to believe it or not, I will tell you that according to Scripture, everything in your life and everything in eternity is determined by how you answer this question. Who do you say that Jesus is?" Now, that in itself is the scandal of Christianity. It's what sets Christianity apart from everything else. You have to answer that question, who is he? And I think that quote really kind of puts in context what we've been saying. Now, there's something you need to understand about Scripture to me that is extremely important. Something you need to understand about reality and the truth of reality itself. And why do I say that? Because, listen, we are today living in a culture where reality is anything you think it to be. You can call reality whatever you want to name it, right? And so we have all these quirky and strange ideas out there where people want to name their own reality. This is what reality is. But that's not true. Reality is truth. And truth is defined as that which is certain. We don't get to name our own reality, if you think about it. And so the question is not, who is Jesus to you? That's not what we're asking. The question is not to me, who do you want Jesus to be? That's not the question. The question is not, who do you make him out to be according to your convenience? That's not the question. The question is, who is Jesus? That's the question. It's not who I think he is. It's not who I hope he is. It's not who I wish him to be. He's not a genie in a lamp, right? Who is Jesus? And the best way to see that is to hear his claims and then go, do I place my faith in those claims? Do I adjust my life to those claims? Is he who he claims to be? And everything in your life, everything in eternity is determined by how you answer that question. And I'm going to tell you, if he is who he claims to be and you adjust your life to him, he is worthy of all worship and honor and glory and praise. He is worthy of you laying down your life for him like he did for you, if he's who he claims to be. And so this whole study has been about, who does Jesus claim to be? Who does he claim to be? I shared a study with you last week from Barna Research. I read another study this week that was put together by the combination of two pretty powerful Christian organizations, Legionnaire Ministries. If you're familiar with R.C. Sproul, he founded Legionnaire Ministries. They partnered with Lifeway Research. That's the research branch of our own Southern Baptist Convention. They partnered, and they put together a survey of Americans to ask them, who is Jesus? Who do you believe him to be? And this came out just this summer. So it's brand new, hot off the presses. This is what right now Americans believe about Jesus. And here's what they found. Listen to this quote according to these two kind of Christian leaders in research, Legionnaire and Lifeway Ministry. Here's what they found. A new survey reveals that 52% of American adults believe that Jesus was a great teacher and nothing more. 52%, that's half of this country, okay, just believes that Jesus was a real person, but a great teacher, but that's it. He is nothing more. But it went on. Almost a third of evangelicals, 30%, of professed believers and Christians agree that Jesus was merely a great teacher. That's people sitting in our pews in our churches. 30% of professing Christians said Jesus was just a great teacher, all right? And while 66% of American evangelicals disagree with that statement, Jesus was a good teacher, but he was not God. What's really alarming is that another 65% came along and said, Jesus is the first and greatest created being by God, created by God. That's also erroneous. I mean, think about that just a little bit, what you're hearing. We don't really know who Jesus is. If you think Jesus was a created being, you've missed his claims, who he claims to be. Jesus claims to be God in the flesh. And he either is that, or he's a liar, or he's a lunatic. And you got to decide, who is he? And so that's the question that we're kind of probing in this study that I want us to dig into and look at. Now, this morning, we're going to look at the next one. So you can let go of Matthew 16 now. We're going to be in John chapter 6. I told you that if you really want to get to know Jesus, if you want to know who he is, that's why John's gospel was written. John's gospel is different than Matthew, Mark, or Luke. It kind of stands alone in kind of its place in the synoptic gospels. It doesn't record a lot of the parables of Jesus. We talked about that when we finished our parable story. Matter of fact, there's no parables in the Gospel of John. So you don't see Jesus the storyteller here, because what's John about? It is about exposing us to who Jesus is. And it does that in lots of ways. For one thing, John is pretty famous for the miracles that it talks about in the Gospel of John. 7 miracles in the Gospel of John, and all of them point to who Jesus is. But then Jesus actually makes these claims about who he is. There's 7 of them that appear throughout the Gospel of John. Now, last week we looked at a powerful one where he called himself the light of the world, remember? Jesus said, I am the light. And remember the references to that. Jesus was actually saying, I am God. Because who created light? God created light. Way back in the book of Genesis, God was the giver of light. He created light. And Jesus used that great name, I am, which was the name that God gave Moses in the burning bush, which is the proper name of God. That's literally where in the Hebrew we get the word Yahweh from those letters, I am. And when Jesus said, I am the light of the world, he said, I'm God. So we heard that claim last week that he is God. And we know that that's consistent with what we read throughout Scripture. Remember I mentioned to you the name that the angel gave Joseph to give to the baby Jesus. You will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. He was God with us. And in the first part of the Gospel of John, you can read the words in the very first chapter, in the beginning was the Word. and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus never minced words about who he was. He was God, God in the flesh. Now, either believe that claim, right? And if he's God, he is worthy of worship. He is worthy of us bowing down to him. He is worthy of us depending on him because he claims to be God. But that's not all he claimed. I want to look at another claim that he made today in the 6th chapter of John. And this is really a lengthy passage, so I'm not going to read the whole thing. We're going to skip around in it some. But if you're there, I want you to see this in John chapter 6. And I'm going to begin reading down in verse 32. So find your way down to that if you would. And I want you to hear this. Another great claim of Jesus. And I'll put it in some context here for you in just a minute. But here's what you'll read beginning in verse 32. And I'm going to read on down first of all to verse 35. Look at that with me if you would. Here's what we see in God's word. Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, Moses did not give you bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And then he said to him, "Lord, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, here's a claim of Jesus saying who he is. "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst." There's a claim of Jesus. Now, skip on down, if you would, to verse 48, and let me pick it up there because I want you to see this. He's still talking to them, and he's telling them who he is. Skip on down to verse 48. Here we go. Here's what he says, verse 48. You can just highlight or underline this verse. Jesus makes the claim again. "I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give in my flesh, which I shall give for my life of the world." The Jews therefore quarreled among themselves. You see what's happening here? Three times in just those verses I read, Jesus tells us who he is. Remember, we're talking about who does Jesus say that he is? Who did he say? Three times in that passage he says, "I am the bread of life." Now, let's just be honest. We have read that passage of Scripture many times. If you're a Bible reader, a Bible teacher, you've been in Baptist churches, you've been in church all your life, you've heard that passage many times, and you've probably just glossed over it. You've just kind of thought, "Oh, that's nice. Jesus is the bread of life." And when we take the Lord's Supper, we talk about the bread, and it's the broken body of the Lord. We make all these references to bread, but it never really resonates with us. What's it talking about? Let me give you some context here, again, for what's taking place. In the 6th chapter, along with the 7th, along with the 8th, Jesus has come into Jerusalem, and they're celebrating one of the great feasts of Israel. They're celebrating what's called the Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Booths, and I talked about this one a little bit last week. They had three great feasts, and this particular feast was one that celebrated how God provided and took care of them during the wilderness wandering, God's people. Remember, he set them free from the bondage of slavery in Egypt, and he led them out, but they'd been slaves for hundreds and hundreds of years. They didn't know how to do anything. They weren't warriors. All they knew how to do was make bricks for Pharaoh. That's all they knew. They weren't hunters. They weren't gatherers. They weren't any of those things. They didn't know how to do anything. And here they are in the middle of the desert, a bunch of people who didn't know how to do anything, and somebody got to take care of them, right? Somebody's going to have to provide for them. And that's what they've come to Jerusalem for in the 6th, 7th, 8th chapters of John. And Jesus has come into the temple, and he's beginning to speak to them, and he's making claims, and all of these claims about who he is come right out of the stories of the wilderness wandering. You recognize this story, right? About being bread from heaven. He even makes allusions to it. "Moses gave you bread from heaven," didn't give you bread from heaven. "My Father gave you bread from heaven." And remember when the children of Israel got out in the wilderness and they got hungry and said, "If you brought us out here to die, we'd rather go back to Egypt and be slaves than die in the wilderness." And Moses said, "God will provide." And God said, "I'll rain down manna, bread from heaven, and I will feed them." And now during this part of the festival, they're celebrating that God provided manna for them. When Jesus all of a sudden stands up and says, "I am the bread of life. I'm the bread come down from heaven," and began to apply that to them. So now you get a little bit of context here for what's taking place in our passage of Scripture. So he spoke to him, remember, and he told them, I'm the bread of life. And he makes this kind of connection, this allusion back to that story in the wilderness wanderings when God provided manna from heaven. Now, I'm just going to tell you, God provides. All that you need, God provides. Physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually. God is all you need. When we sang that song a while ago, maybe you never heard it. He's all I need. That's a declaration of who God is, who Jesus is. I'm going to tell you something this morning. I believe that song is biblical. He's all you need. He is all you need. There's people sitting in this room this morning who've been Christians for a really long time, and they understand that. They understand He is the bread of heaven. He's all I need. He satisfies the deepest longings of my heart. He satisfies the cravings of my soul. He is all that I need. He will provide for me. He'll give me all that I need to sustain me in this life. But listen, He will provide for me eternally in heaven. He will provide. He's all you need. And I'm telling you today, what ails this world is what Jesus can provide. How we see our culture drifting, you know what the answer is? It's not another government program. It's not. It's not who's in office. It's not a political party. It's not how educated we are. All those things are fine. All those things are good. It's not how much money we have to throw at individuals who have needs in their life. I'm telling you that what ails the world today, the only answer is Jesus. He is the bread from heaven. He provides. And so I just want to pick this passage apart for you a little bit in John chapter 6 in the little bit of time that we have left. Yes, you're going to get a three-point sermon. It's going to be brief by biblical definitions of brief. It's going to be brief, okay? And I'm going to share this with you. I'll get through it as quickly as I can, but I want you to hear this because when Jesus makes the claim, I'm the bread of life, I'm telling you, that's a claim we got to take seriously. And you and I this morning, if that's who He claims to be and we believe that's who He is, we need to lay hold of the truths of who He's telling us He is and depend on it, all right? So let's think about it just a little bit, kind of dig into it. What's He telling us when He says He is the bread of heaven? First of all, just jot this down. When Jesus says that He is the bread of heaven, He is saying to us that He alone saves us. He alone saves us. Now, you guys have been coming to church here long enough, and you know that when I preach, I'm going to preach Jesus. And you've heard me say many times from this pulpit, there is no other way to salvation except through Jesus. He is it. That's not original with me. That's from here. Okay? He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peter, in one of the greatest sermons ever preached in Peter, the fourth chapter, will say, there is salvation found in no other, for there's no other name given among men by which we must be saved other than Jesus. He is the only way. You're not going to get into heaven by having a church's name tattooed on you, right? You're not going to get into heaven by being a Baptist or a Methodist or a Pentecostal or a Catholic or any of those things. That's not what's going to get you into heaven. Only the bread of heaven can get you into heaven. Right? Only Jesus. So when He says, I'm the bread of heaven, He is telling us that He alone saves. And you go, boy, brother, buddy, that seems like a stretch. Where are you getting that? Well, I'm getting that right from the context of Scripture. And I want you to understand this and kind of get this down just a little bit. Now, when Jesus said, I'm the bread of heaven, if you notice, He was kind of putting that in the context of this great feast that's taking place at the temple where He's teaching them, and He's reminding them that Jesus provided, that God provided manna from heaven to feed the people, but He kind of gives us this context. Look at verse 32. Here's what He said. Jesus said to him, most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you bread from heaven, but my Father gives you true bread from heaven. Moses didn't make manna rain down. He just told the people that God was going to make manna rain down. Bread from heaven doesn't come from man. It comes from God. He causes the bread to come. He causes the manna to come down. Now, what just happened there, if you look back at that story, is He's making this connection between who Jesus is and that story that would have resonated with all of those Jewish people gathered around to celebrate this particular feast. Moses didn't give them the bread. He did. Think about this. What would have happened to the children of Israel who wandered in the wilderness for 40 years if God didn't give them bread to eat? What physically would have happened to them? they would have died. If God didn't send bread out in the desert, there's nothing to eat. You might can live for a little while off of some little bug you find out there. I don't know. I don't really want to eat bugs, but I mean, you might be able to survive. But if you've ever seen those great stories of survival where they drop people off in the middle of the desert and you watch that, they can't find anything to eat. They scavenger for food. Well, these people hadn't been doing anything but making bricks for hundreds of years. They didn't know how to provide for themselves. And so God rained down manna from heaven. Manna, by the way, is an interesting phrase, and I'm not going to get into all these texts today because I'll run out of time kind of digging into this because this is a rich story. But if you really want to know what the word manna means in Hebrew, it means, what is it? That's what it literally means. It rained down from heaven. They went, what is it? And Moses said, this is what God has provided for you to eat. You'll gather enough for you and your family every day. Don't keep it past midnight, because if you do, it's going to turn to maggots. You can go back and read the story yourself. In the morning, some of them had kept it, and God said, these are stiff-necked people. Will they never learn? And it stunk up the camp. They were given enough every day to provide for them. When they went to bed at night, they didn't have to wonder what they were going to eat tomorrow. It was going to be manna. God provided for them. And go back and read the story sometime. You know when God's quit raining down manna from heaven? When they entered the promised land. For 40 years, every day, without miss, God provided all that they needed until they reached the promised land. Now you apply that spiritually to your life. The promise is when Jesus says, I am the bread of life, he's saying, I will save you and I will carry you into the promised land. When you get to the promised land, you will be saved because I provided you the bread of life, the bread of heaven. You think, where did he do that? Well, let's make the reference here to the Lord's Supper for a second. At the Lord's Supper, we're remembering what? That. Right? We're remembering his shed blood and his broken body for us. And that is symbolized by what? Wine and broken bread. The broken body of our Lord. How does he provide bread for us every single day that saves us? By giving himself on a cross. His body was broken for you and me. He's the only way of salvation. He's how you and I are saved. He's how we come into him. And if you read this passage in John chapter 6, you'll see him saying things like, listen, this bread from heaven they ate in the wilderness and they died. But the bread of heaven that I have to give them, if you take this bread, you will live forever. You will never die. You know why? Because when you trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior and he saves you, he gives you eternal life, everlasting life, and you will never perish. You know the verse, say it with me. Not even going to put it on the screen because you know it. John 3:16, for God, say it with me, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. When Jesus said, I am the living bread, come down from heaven. If you eat this bread, you will never die. He meant it. Jesus can give you an abundant life now and he can give you eternal life then. This bread will carry you through this life into heaven. That's powerful. So jot it down, right? When Jesus said, I'm the bread of life, he is saying he alone saves. Like the manna from heaven saved in the wilderness, he alone says. Here's the second thing. This gets deeper. You ready? Here's the next one. When Jesus says he's the bread of life, he is saying that he fully satisfies. He fully satisfies. Notice verse 35. Here's what it says. I am the bread of life, which he who comes to me shall never hunger. Never. And he who believes in me shall never thirst. That's an interesting kind of statement that he makes there. You know, there's certain things that I can eat, and within about an hour, I'll be hungry again. They never satisfy, right? A salad. Right? That's something Buddy's supposed to eat a lot of and probably doesn't eat enough of, because if I eat it, I'm going to be hungry, right? Chinese food's like that for me, too. Eat Chinese food, 2 hours, I'm hungry again, right? There's things that we eat, sometimes we go, that just never satisfies, never fills me. Well, you know what Jesus is saying when he says, I'm the bread of life? I fully satisfy. If you eat this bread, you'll never hunger again. You'll never thirst again. He's the answer to the longings, the cravings, the yearnings of our soul, of our heart. We try to satisfy the deepest hungerings and thirstings of our heart, our life, our soul, with all kinds of things that can't satisfy. Man's doing that today, thinking that all the things that he ties himself into this world, maybe it's relationships, maybe it has to do with material possessions, maybe it has to do with friendships or those kinds of things. We try to find all kinds of things to fill the emptiness in us, the longing, the hungerings in us. And I am telling you that those will never be satisfied until they're satisfied in Jesus. Never. They will not be satisfied. The prophet Isaiah said it like this in Isaiah 29:8. This is such a peculiar and interesting passage, but I want you to think about what the prophet Isaiah is saying here. He says, "It shall even be as when a hungry man dreams, and look, he eats, but when he awakes, and his soul is still empty. Or as when a thirsty man dreams, and look, he drinks, but he awakes, and indeed, he is faint, and his soul still craves." Do you see what he's saying there? The prophet Isaiah is saying, it's like this with man. It's like we think all of these things are going to satisfy us. We dream about all of these things, right, that are going to fill us, that are going to meet the longing. But then when we wake up, we realize there's still an emptiness there. It can't satisfy. And I am telling you 100% today, that longing, that yearning, that emptiness, that craving inside of you is never fully satisfied until you meet Jesus. He is the bread of life. He's the hope that we have. Isaiah would say just a few chapters later, and I think this is interesting too, in Isaiah 55:2, "Why do you spend money for what is not bread and for wages for what does not satisfy?" There's only one thing that satisfies, and that's God come down, right? That's Jesus Christ. He satisfies the deepest longings of our heart. Y'all know I love the Psalms. I talk all the time about how I read from the Psalms almost every day as a part of my quiet time, and I love them. And here's one that I found this week. It's in Psalm 107, verse 9. And it's short. It just says this: "For he, God, satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness." Now, you just take that little verse home with you and meditate on it for a minute. I want you just to begin to lean into that verse a little bit and get what it's saying to us. For God satisfies the longings. He fills the hungering soul, and he fills it with goodness. And that's a powerful truth if you think about that. He satisfies the very depths of who we are. Psalm 78, verses 23 through 25 says this, and I think this is powerful. "Yet he commanded the clouds above and opened the doors of heaven, had rained down manna on them to eat, and given them the bread of heaven. Men ate angels' food. He sent them food to the full." You get that? That's how God treats us, if you're his. He doesn't necessarily give you everything you want. He gives you everything that you need. And he satisfies the depths of our heart, the depths of our souls, for he satisfies the longing soul and fills the hungry soul with goodness. We sang it while ago in the middle of that song, right? He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. He's satisfied. My needs provide. You get it? That's what we're professing when we say that. When Jesus said, "I'm the bread of life," he said, "I alone save and I alone satisfy." I can satisfy. I don't know what the longing of your heart is today, what you're searching for, what you're wanting, what you're wishing for in your own life, what you're hoping for. But I'm telling you, Jesus made some claims that say, I can meet that need. I can satisfy that longing. I can quench that thirsting. I can satisfy. Here's the last one. You ready? Got to get you this last one because I think it's powerful. Here it is. When Jesus says that he is the bread of life, he's saying that he alone saves, that he satisfies us to the full, and he's saying that he is faithful to strengthen us. Now, can you imagine being out in the wilderness, in that desert, 40 years, wandering around? Now, we've endured a little heat, I would say, right? I mean, my temperature gauge at my house on Thursday said 106. Okay, that's pretty hot. But can you imagine being out in the hot sands of the desert every day, the sun's beating down on you, right? Not 106, but let's say 114, 150, 120. Maybe at other times even higher. There's no shade to be found unless you create it with a tent, right? There's no food to eat unless God rains it down from heaven, right? And how are you going to wander for 40 years with nothing to eat? Well, you'll die. And how are they going to roam the desert, the wilderness, for 40 years if something doesn't sustain them? If something doesn't give them strength daily to go on? Now, I'm going to ask you this question as a Christian. It's hard to live in our world today. It's like a wilderness, right? Do you ever get weary as a Christian? Do you ever get just tired? You hear the constant onslaught of things that are ungodly and against God's word. Attacks on the church. Attacks on the Christian faith. Things that we know are morally wrong and against Scripture. Do you ever just get weary? I do. I'm going to tell you, if you want to keep from getting weary, don't watch the news, right? Don't read the papers. Do you see what I'm saying? I mean, we get weary. What sustains us as Christians? How do we daily have the strength to go on and live the Christian life constantly when it's an onslaught of attacks trying to pull us this way and that way, even trying to divide the church at times? How do we go on? How do we do it? Can I tell you? The bread of life. The bread of life sustains us. He faithfully strengthens us for what he calls us to do. And when he makes this claim, boy, it couldn't be a better one, right? Not only does he save us, but the deepest longings of our heart and soul, he satisfies. And how am I going to live it every single day, wandering around the heat of this world, scorching me, pulling me this way and that, pulling me away from him? How am I going to make it? Well, he strengthens you to live it every single day. That's why we sing the song, "He's All I Need." He's all I need. When we say, "Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord," we're saying, "All you alone can satisfy. You alone can strengthen me for what I'm called to do," when we sing it. You get it? When we sing the song, "This is the air I breathe. This is my daily bread," we sing. How do we go on? How do we live every single day? By this claim that Jesus made about who he is. "I'm the bread of life." If you've never partaken of the bread of life, Jesus' invitation to you is, "Come, and I will in no wise cast you out." You got your Bibles open still? I want you to see this. Look at John chapter 6. I didn't read all the way down. Just look at your Bible there, verse 37. "All that the Father gives me will come. By no means cast out." Folks, that's the good news. When Jesus made the claim, "I'm the bread of life," he came to feed all of us. In the 6th chapter of John, you go back and read the chapter begins by hundreds, thousands of people sitting around Jesus, hearing him teach, and by the end of the day, they're sun-drenched, they're hungry, and Jesus takes a little boy's lunch, and he breaks the bread and gives thanks, and multiplies the fishes and the loaves and feeds them. He is the bread of life. He's still doing that today. He saves, he satisfies, he strengthens. Would you bow with me for a word of prayer? With heads bowed and eyes closed, I don't know. I can't pretend to even guess what God might be speaking in your heart today. I know the things he's been showing me this week. He's put his finger on my life this week a few times and said, "Buddy, you're trying to let these things satisfy you. I'm what satisfies. You're trying to let these things be your strength. I am your strength." We need to let God be who he claims to be. Christian, first of all, he saved you. Now let him satisfy you. And let him strengthen you to live it every single day. And this morning in this place, there's some of us who need to recommit ourselves to him and say, "Jesus, you claim to be the bread of life. I want you as the bread of life in my life." There may be some in this room this morning that have never asked Jesus to come into their life and save them. When he said, "I'm the bread of life," he said, "I alone save. I alone satisfy. And I can strengthen you to live it." And maybe right here in this room, and we're not trying to put you on the spot or embarrass you. That's not our purpose here. These are commitments and decisions that you make between you and the Lord. If you'll call on his name right now, he'll pour out the manna in your life. Trust him. Invite him in. Ask him to save you. That's why he came, to give you life. Ask him in. So here's what I'm going to do. Our time is gone, and we're not going to tarry long like we did last week. We're going to be brief here. If God has spoken to your heart and you need to come, the altar's open. Our ministers are here. We'll pray with you. You could slip to your knees in that pew and seek God's face. I don't know what he said to you, but we're not going to tarry long. We're just going to declare in this song, he's all I need. And if God's spoken to your heart in some way and you need to respond, we're going to invite you to come. Father, we turn this over to you now. God, I believe your word has gone out and your Holy Spirit's taken it and spoken it into hearts. And God, it doesn't return void. And God, there may be some in this place this morning who need to respond to you in some way. Maybe during the service, maybe after the service. God, we just want you to have your way this morning. You are our bread from heaven, just as you claim to be. We believe that. We confess that. We profess it this morning. And we ask you to pour out your bread from heaven on us this morning in this place today. Give those who may need to respond to you the courage to come this morning, and we'll give you the praise. It's in your name we ask these things. Amen. Would you stand?